Michaela Morehouse, and my research this last couple semesters has been over parasitism and color polymorphism in lesser snow geese. So in my presentation, we'll go over a brief flight history. What is color polymorphism and what is nest parasitism? What we are looking for and what kind of data we are using, the process we went through, and where we currently are in that process. So the life history of lesser snow geese is that their breeding grounds is in Canada and northern Alaska. They migrate down the central and Mississippi, Pacific, and Atlantic pathways. They are colonial nesters, which means they like to nest around a lot of other snow geese. They lay about 2 to 6 eggs per clutch. They have one brood per season. The young are precocial, which means they're born ready. They come out with down and pretty much ready to walk and feeding on their own. There's not a lot of parenting on that regard. And they prefer ponds, shallow lakes, coastal salt marshes. So our samples were collected in the upper part of Wapusk National Park, right around Churchill, over the summers of 2016 and 2017. If you look, you can see that this area is up here, which is kind of gives you an idea of where it is compared to Winnipeg. And so that kind of helps you understand where these are coming from. Our samples are collected in a grid-like pattern, and so we can tell where they were in relation to the other nests, how many were in that exact spot, and even all the way down to the individual egg that was collected in that area. So from our collections, we got 583 shells, which gives us the maternal DNA, and then 499 offspring DNA from the membranes. This difference between the two is caused by nest depredations, and so the egg is eaten before the offspring's DNA develops enough to a point where we would be able to extract it. So what is color polymorphism? Well, in snow geese, it basically means they come in two colors, white and blue. These colors are maintained by the geese due to imprinting on their mother's color. And so when they see the mother's color, they think they are that color. And then later in life, when they go to choose that mate, they want to choose a mate that looks more like them. But with nest parasitism, you might have a blue morph that thinks it's white and choosing a white mate and vice versa. So since they're attracted to their mother's phenotype, they usually stay pretty well regulated. The La Perouse population was originally white, and then the Fox Basin population were primarily blue, and due to human development, their wintering grounds had to merge as their areas got used up. And so that merging has caused them to kind of morph into each other and overlap. And so now we're seeing a rise in heterogeneous blue morphs. The blue comes in at varying levels. We're not sure exactly why. And due to that not being the nature of our question, we're not looking more into that. So for all of our purposes, they're either white or blue. So this blue is defined by the MCU1R allele, which is basically a melanin regulation gene. And it's pretty specific on what mutation needs to occur to change whether or not they're blue or white. And so we can look down at that one mutation, which allows us to do it pretty quickly on phenotyping them. So our main question is, why is this color basing? And we think it is due to brood parasitism. So what is brood parasitism? Well, the parasite mother lays an egg outside of the mother's. Outside of the mother's is supposed to play, but outside of the mother's nest, and then it kind of brings the egg into its own nest. And so that's where you get the parasite egg into the host nest. We believe this is, again, due to the merging of the southern breeding grounds, because as they merge, they pair up with another goose and that they think is their mother's color, but they're more likely to, or they have more options to choose someone of another color. And so then you go back to their breeding grounds, and they can lay an egg thinking they're a white goose, just laying an egg somewhere else in another white goose nest, because they're part of that white goose population, but really they're putting a blue egg in it, and that's how this develops. So this video was supposed to be a picture of her trying to get it in, and ultimately she gives up and it stays where it's at. But what you end up with is a nest where you can have two blue morphs and a white morph in the same nesting bowl, and one of them is going to be a little confused on their coloring. So why is this interesting? Well, we get a chance to understand evolution through something that isn't pressured by natural selection. There's no sexual selection. They're not being chosen because this one's more blue or this one's more white. They're just being chosen because they have that color at all. And there's no fitness selection because their color doesn't change whether or not they're going to be predated on. So what are we looking for? Well, our objectives is to quantify rates of nest parasitism in their relation to the host phenotype. And then how we're going to do that is by comparing the DNA of each offspring within the nest to each other to determine if nest parasitism took place. Followed by that, we can determine from the mother's DNA and the offspring's, we can determine their phenotypes and how that relates to the nest parasitism. And so what kind of data are we looking at? We're looking at genotype, matrilineage, sex, and their phenotype. So phenotype is important because that's what gives us our coloring. Genotype is important because looking at that, we can say this one is an actual nest parasitype, and it's not just because they're just really close and you just happen to have that one light-haired kid and your brown-haired kid's offspring, right? So, and then again, using our genotype, we can establish the matrilineage. So our process was sample sorting. When they were initially collected, they were collected just the whole egg and membrane, or the whole shell and membrane, just put in an envelope, labeled thoroughly, and then packed away for the summer. And so what we had to do in fall was go through, separate the shell from the membrane, again, separating that maternal DNA from the offspring DNA, and putting them into these little tubes so we can get them ready for the extraction stuff. So we're not mixing the two as we're trying to extract this DNA. We had to start prepping them for sequencing, which sequencing is where we get all of our information. So our prep required us to extract the DNA, and then add our primers. The primers are basically little bounty hunters that go out. We tell them exactly what we want to look for. They kind of hold it up for us, and so we know exactly what we're amplifying. Then we do a PCR, amplifying the DNA, so we can see that that is there, and that we're not having just an empty extraction kit, because some of our samples can have so little DNA in it that we're not going to get any information from it. And so the PCR lets us know that it is there. And then once all of our primers are in, all the DNA is extracted, everything looks good, we combine it in a tube, do a quality check on it, and then we send it off to the medical building for sequencing. When we get the sequencing back from the medical building, we go through and genotype it, make sure we're saying this is the primary one in this goose, this is what they are, and then analyzing it. How does that compare to what answers our questions? So our current position in this process is that we finished our sample sorting in October, We finished our preliminary results in testing in January, so we sent them off in January to the medical building. During that time, so our preliminary results was 47 samples out of the 1,079 total, and looking at our quality checks, everything looked really good, and we were pretty excited about it. So we sent it off. While we were waiting, we continued our DNA extractions, and over spring break, we received our results, and yeah, they're messy, but they are encouraging. Right now, we know that they probably are going to give us the kind of information we're looking for at this point. And so right now, what we're doing is just looking at the genotypes, getting all that preliminary stuff worked through, and then analyzing it. And in the meantime, also finish extracting and prepping those other samples. So I want to say a big thank you to Brian Darby, my mentor, who's sitting over there, for being super patient with me and helping us along and helping explain things thoroughly on my level. To Sam Hervey, he was the graduate student whose project I built off of, and he's the one who actually did these sample collections over those two summers and done a lot of showing me how to use the lab equipment and everything. And to the McNair program for helping me get into it and helping compensate my time and getting me excited about doing research. Any questions?
This is a behavioral question, so you might not know, but so the ones that lay the eggs and try to put in other nests, do they do that consistently or is it just a one-off thing?
We're not entirely sure. That's one of the things that we're looking up. It's a developing field. It's not seen a lot, and they're unique because they only do it to other individuals of their species, and so we're not sure if they do it like once a year or every other couple of years. And
are they banded, so you know whether they ever have their own nests?
We don't band them. Okay. I'm sure someone somewhere does. So our project is just going to that same spot every year and collecting that DNA, and eventually we'll have enough DNA to be like, oh, this person, this is what their lineage is.
This person.
This goose. After you spend so many hours looking at their DNA, you feel pretty close to them. Any other questions? Yes?
I was curious about the sequencing, like you mentioned the polymer chain reaction, and then do they run the electrophoresis gel, or how do they do the sequencing?
Yep, we do a PCR, and then we run it through the electrophoresis, and it's just a pretty basic PCR. We're mainly using it as a means to know that there is DNA in it, simply because we are already going to send it off for sequencing, and that will tell us in more detail what the DNA looks like, so we're not interested in necessarily and like the banding or anything. We're just, is there something in here and how strongly is it showing? Any others? All right, thank you.